Good morning.
Morning.
Welcome to the 15th annual ceremony of the Georgia Writers Hall of Fame, where we believe that one day the sun will come out again. The University of Georgia's Harvard Rare Book and Manuscript Library established the hall in 2000 to celebrate Georgia writers past and present whose work reflects the character of our state and Georgia's rich literary legacy. I'm Toby Graham. I'm the university librarian and associate provost here at the University of Georgia. And what a pleasure it is to gather with all of you today to induct Vereen Bell, Taylor Branch, Paul Hemphill, and Janisse Ray into the Georgia Writers Hall of Fame. This year's inductees bring the hall to 52. Anyone may nominate someone for induction into the Georgia Writers Hall of Fame, and we have a distinguished panel of judges that meet annually to select those who are invited to join this august group. And I'd like to recognize our judges now. And so those of you who are with us, please stand as I say your name. Mrs. Mary Adams, I don't believe she's with us today. Lisa Baer, who is the director of the University of Georgia Press. Lisa? Dr. Stephen Corey, who directs the Georgia Review. Stephen's in the back. Peggy Gallus from here in Athens, Georgia. Good morning, Peggy. Mary Hood, who is a 2014 inductee into the hall. Julie Hunt. I know I saw Julie. Thank you so much for being here from Tifton, Georgia. Dr. John Insko from the History Department. John? Shell Knox from Augusta, Georgia. Good morning, Shell. Dr. John Lowe from UGA's English Department. Dr. Barbara McGaskill, also from English. Dr. Judson Mitchum, who is in the back there. Judson is an inductee into the Georgia Writers Hall of Fame and Georgia's Poet Laureate. Dr. Hugh Rupersberg, who convened our panel yesterday. He is the Senior Associate Dean for the Franklin College of Arts and Sciences. Alfred Urey is not able to be with us here today, and he is one of our Hall of Famers. Lisa White from Savannah. Neely Young, who heads Georgia Trend Magazine. Thank you, Neely. And Dr. Jamil Zinaldine. And Jamil is the President of the Georgia Humanities Council. I want to acknowledge all the efforts of all the UGA Libraries employees who were involved in our programming and in our exhibit, Leander Nessel and Chantel Dunham, Skip Hewlett, Mary Linneman, Kat Stein, Chuck Barber, Gene Cleveland, Mary Ellen Brooks, behind the camera, Christian Lopez. Thank you so much for your hard work. I need to express our deep gratitude to the late George Montgomery and to Nancy Montgomery, whose love of literature, whose philanthropic spirit led them to create the Georgia Writers Hall of Fame Endowment to ensure that we continue this program, that we'd be able to recognize the literary talent of Georgians for many years to come. A warm welcome to our Hall of Famers who are with us today. We have Terry Kay. Terry, where are you? There's Terry. Glad to have you with us today. And Judson is a part of the hall as well. And then we have James Kilgo, representing James Kilgo. We're so glad that you're with us. Do we have any others representing any of our existing inductees today? I will make one special acknowledgement here. One of the things that we did this year to promote reading of these wonderful authors was to have a special program that we sent out to book clubs around the state so that they could pick up books from the authors to include. But there's one in Athens that is not a book club, it is the book club, I understand. And so I know we have some members of the book club who are here, and so we welcome all of you as well. And most certainly, we'd like to extend a very special welcome to our inductees and to their families, their representatives, Taylor Branch, Janisse Ray, Susan Percy, Vereen Bell Jr., and to their guests. It's been such a pleasure over the past day to interact with all of you and your families. We're grateful for your presence with us this morning. And so now I'd like to introduce to you Dr. John Lowe, the Barbara Methven Professor of English at the University of Georgia and a member of the Georgia Writers Hall of Fame Board of Judges, to induct Vereen Bell. Dr. Lowe.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's a pleasure and honor to join you here today to present the legacy of a great Georgia writer and to thank my fellow board members for voting him into the Georgia Writers Hall of Fame. Vereen McNeil Bell was born in Cairo. Yes, that is the way we pronounce it. The son of Chief Justice Reason Chestnut Bell of the Supreme Court of the state and Jenny Vereen. He graduated from North Carolina's Davidson College in 1932 and started a literary career working with his mentor, Frederick Lytton, in Lake Charles, Louisiana, where he wrote for juvenile magazines, eventually becoming associate editor of the American Boy in Detroit. He came back to Georgia, however, and married Florence Elmore Daniel of Thomasville. They took residence near Cairo and he had two sons, Vereen McNeil Jr. and Frederick Daniel. Bell was happiest working from home where he wrote about rural Southerners and their complex interaction with the surrounding wilderness. He and his wife built a modern dwelling that was inspired by the architecture of Frank Lloyd Wright. They loved to host raucous parties and especially loved running quail nuts. Bell took his sons hunting and they fished from their cabin cruiser. His stories were published in the Saturday Evening Post, Collier's, American, Field and Stream, and other leading magazines of the time during a period when these journals functioned as America's TV, so to speak. Bell's magazine career paralleled that of another Southern writer, one William Faulkner, whose magazine Potboilers, as he called it, kept him afloat at times when his novels weren't selling, and some of Faulkner's later stories, I think, are suspiciously like Bell's. When World War II erupted, Bell volunteered for the Navy and was initially assigned to a bomber squadron. Eventually, though, he was posted on the escort aircraft carrier at the Gambier Bay, which engaged in the Battle for Leyte Gulf. He was killed when his ship went down in the Second Battle of the Philippines. He was only 33, but he left a legacy in his family and in his writing. The first of his novels, Swamp Water, 1940, is set in the Okefenokee Swamp, which knew well. Using sturdy yet often eloquent language, he limned a shadowy realm that is feared and mythologized. Paradoxically, however, it nourishes and inspires several characters who are brave enough to enter and forms a refuge for unjustly accused members of society. The margins of the swamp receive lively presentation. This Bell depicts local socials, homely music, courting rituals, and the hardships and triumphs of a frontier community. The novel presents the coming-of-age story of Ben Reagan, who bonds with Tom Kiefer, a refugee of the swamp, incurring the enmity of would-be poachers and most of the community, who feel he's protecting a criminal. Paralleling this tale, the hero is betrayed by his selfish girlfriend, but then finds a new love with an orphaned serving girl. The dramatic conclusion of the novel evokes horror, pity, and admiration for the finer qualities of the hero, his new partner, and the sturdy peasants who befriend them. The villains of the piece are two poachers who cruelly hunt plumed birds for feathers during the mating season when they know the faithful birds will stay near their nest. To his credit, Ben refuses to violate the code of the honorable hunter, and at the novel's end, this evil pair who seek to capture Kiefer receive a fitting punishment. Throughout the story, we see a thematic of sustainability as the swamp people respect the dangers, but also the bounty there. Its impenetrability and mystery, the book suggests, will always protect the land of trembling earth from the baser aspects of human nature. Swamp Water's been made into two full-length movies, and the first and more praised eponymous version, 1941, was directed by Jean Renoir, the celebrated French auteur who was the son of the impressionist painter Pierre-Auguste Renoir. Partly filmed in Waycross and starring a young Dana Andrews, Ann Baxter, Walter Brennan, Ward Bond, and John Carradine was a starry cast. The film has been widely studied in film courses and has taken on the configuration of a classic. Although Renoir simplified the plot to make it fit the limits of a feature, he stayed true to the basic parameters and in some ways improved them. A second movie, this time filmed in Technicolor, was entitled Lure of the Wilderness, 1952, and it starred Jeffrey Hunter, Gene Peters, and interestingly, once again, William Brennan in the same role. Walter in the same role. A second novel, Two of a Kind, 1943, also makes excellent use of his wilderness setting as it traces the relationship between a wild vagrant, Duff Webster, and an equally wild, but pedigreed pointer dog, Judas. The two meet in the wilderness as they compete for game. Two of a Kind was the logical sequel to Swampwater, as it continued a mostly rural backwoods setting and also featured a romantic melodrama. The hero, Duff, has to choose between the somewhat plain but wise and witty Lucy and the beautiful but shallow vamp, Delia. The title, as mentioned, refers to the kinship Duff shares with the wild dog he first encounters, Judas, who it turns out was sired by a champion bird dog, Sam. Capturing Judas, Duff proceeds to the address on the dog's collar to gain a reward and is hired by the family that owns him, eventually rising to be a trainer for the Hawthorne family's kennels. In the course of the novel, we share their experiences as Duff is tamed by his rewarding career and by the hard lessons he learns in his brief but unhappy marriage to Delia. Properly ready now for the real marriage he was destined for with Lucy, he becomes a legendary handler himself like her grandfather Amos. Lucy, by the way, is a passionate horsewoman and outdoors aficionado, qualities that suggest she and Duff are similarly two of a kind. The novel also dares to take on racial oppression in the African-American characters of Wesley and his son Paul, who also work for the kennel. Wesley is a variation on the old faithful servant scenario of the Old South, but Paul, the son, tries to escape prejudice and poverty by fleeing north, only to find his lack of degrees and down-home aspects lead to dead ends. Defeated, he comes home, and Duff, no liberal but no racist either, hires both him and his father to train pointers. Here, Duff and Paul also seem to be two of a kind, despite racial barriers. Significantly, at the end, Duff begins calling Judas Jude, and if you know your saints, you know that Jude is the patron of lost causes. This slight change underlines the thematic of never giving up, keeping one's faith, and of constantly working to achieve a balance between humanity and nature. The novel takes us to hunting trials in Tennessee and Canada, and Bell makes us see both the differences in terrain and the pluses and minuses of the virtually all-male communities that throng to these events. There is surely no other novel that presents such a complete portrait of this little-known field in American sport and culture. Bell was ideally suited to write this book, as the South Georgia he grew up in had long been a legendary site for bird hunters from over the all around the nation. Thomasville in particular was noted for its rich coveys of quail and the excellent accommodations. Over time, hunters from the north built lavish lodges in the area and had magnificent hunt parties. While Bell's plots may seem simple, his skillful narration and richly detailed descriptions keep the reader's interest while raising scores of questions about the surrounding culture. The novel reminds me of two more recent ones, Philip Roth's American Pastoral, which sets the central and tragic story of the Swede and his terrible terrorist daughter against the backdrop of his long involvement in glove manufacturing. Another text that fits this pattern is Vikram Seth's A Suitable Boy, whose central figure, yes, gets involved in a romantic plot, but also rises as the master of a tanning business. Like Roth and Seth, Bell takes his readers through every aspect of dog training, hunting scenes, and the grand trials that lead to coveted awards, including the Grand National. Bell also wrote a number of short stories, and many of them also feature canines. They were collected in a reduced size, Armed Services edition, I have it here, a rare book, under the title Rag Dog and Other Stories During World War II for circulation to our troops. And the volume would easily fit into the pocket of a uniform. And other authors in the series included John O'Hara, John Steinbeck, James Thurber, James M. Kane, and surprisingly, Virginia Woolf. The story's titles are evocative of Bell's consuming interest, Trouble's Child, The Sounds of Geese, Jumping Horseman, The Gopher Dog, Comeback Tuesday, Mortgage on a Dog, The Something Dog, The Hunting Fool, and A Wave of Swamp Looks. Vereen Bell Jr., the writer's son, became a celebrated professor at Vanderbilt University, where he still teaches. And many years ago, when I was an undergraduate there, I was lucky enough to take two courses with him. 2 years ago, when I came to, I'd just been here a year, I decided to teach Georgia literature, and I wanted to use text that spoke to all the different areas and populations of our state. Swamp Water was an obvious choice, especially it's long been one of the most popular Brown Thrasher series books for our University of Georgia Press. I've always been particularly drawn to this novel. My wife is from Valdosta, and we spent many enchanted hours on the Okefenokee's waterways. I've also heard many tales and legends that grew out of the swamp, which parallel the interbraided narrative of Bell's work. As the Methuen professor, I had discretionary funds I could use to augment my courses, so I was able to invite Vereen down for a lecture, which covered his father's life, the novel, and the Renoir film. And after the talk, we screened Swamp Water to my appreciative students and a large company of fellow academics and townspeople. Our new UGA Libraries Director, Dr. Toby Graham, attended, and I introduced him to Vereen. Since then, Dr. Graham and I have been in contact with Vereen, who has now agreed to donate his father's papers to the Heart of Rare Book Library. These papers, I was excited to learn, include an unpublished novel, which Vereen might submit to UGA Press, at least are you listening, for possible release to the public. I was also determined to provide a course on Georgia writers because I believe in an old African proverb that states, no people should be hungry for their own image. In his indelible fiction, Vereen Bell gave us an enduring and inspiring portrait of pioneering Georgians who created a unique relationship with nature in texts that have special meaning for us today as we rethink our relationship to the environment. Please join me in welcoming Professor Vereen Bell Jr., who has kept his father's tradition of eloquence and instruction burning bright.
God took up all my material, so I don't have very much to say. But I was thinking this morning and last night, one thing I really want to say about my dad that I've never really said out loud. John covered all this ground, but I have been thinking on this occasion in particular that when with this story sort of embedded in the biographical part that John started presenting. But he was living a really good life. As a writer, he did just exactly what it is that he wanted to do all of his life. And he hunted and fished and then wrote stories about hunting and fishing and then made money off of the stories that he wrote about hunting and fishing. How bad could that be, you know? I tried that for about 2 days and it didn't work out. He had a great, beautiful wife, and he had a wonderful house in a wonderful neighborhood in Thomasville, Georgia. He had two wonderful sons, one of which was me. by the way, he has extended downstream through his gene pool, three wonderful children that come through me, and yet one other that comes through me from him, that's sitting back there in the back. And when the war came, there was a debate. I talked to my mother, who is still alive in Quitman, Georgia, and still a lot smarter and a lot livelier than my two sisters, who have to take care of or want her to be. My sister told me last week that they were praying for dementia. I was talking to her last week because I knew I was coming here, and I said, how did you go about making the decision when he was 31 years old, had a family, had a wonderful life, had everything to look forward to, had these two novels that did blind eyes, not just in Thomasville, but, you know, across the East, where people read these novels. How did you make the decision that he should go to war? And she said, your grandfather, his father, opposed it because he thought he ought to be staying there to take care of his family, which is, of course, an appropriate thing for somebody that age, man of that age, to be doing. None of his other friends in Thomasville that I know of actually volunteered. Which in retrospect sort of pisses me off when I think about it. I've been writing about them lately, so not in that tone. But she said, my mother said, well, we just sat down at the table one night and decided it was the right thing to do, which it was. And we traveled, so he enlisted, and it's sort of an indication of what Navy bureaucracy was like at that time, that they thought that he would be, because he hunted quail and doves and turkeys and stuff, that he would be a good gunnery instructor, teach people how to use fire, you know, cannons off of battleships and stuff. And if he had done that, he would have been able to stay stateside because he had been a trainer, but he declined to do that. And so went in the Navy, and we followed them around. We followed them from Quonset as a family to Seaside, Oregon, where there was a naval base, and finally down to San Diego. And all along that way, I was conscious as a child that these men that were his age, who had given up their lives too, were a really special breed of people, and they bonded in a way that is almost electric, and I can almost feel it now. Because they knew what they were doing, they knew what was at stake, they were all about, they all had the same sort of trajectory in their lives. And then when he was in the Pacific and he was killed, as John points out, in the Battle of Lake Eyal, which was one of the, if you know anything about naval history at all, you know that, and if you want to know more about it, I can tell you later, was one of the great naval, if not the great naval battle in American naval history, in which about six escort carriers, baby carriers who were there in order to give support, air support to troops that had landed on Leyte, and about eight American destroyers, sank two Japanese cruisers who had sailed into the Gulf and cornered them there, and ran off basically the whole Japanese Navy, which at that point in the context of the battle was about five battleships, six cruisers, and 11 destroyers, and these six little destroyers and the aircraft carriers who called in flight from other aircraft carrier units just ran them off. That was the end of the battle. And the Gambia Bay was the only carrier that was sunk. And there were maybe 157 survivors from the Gambia Bay. And my grandfather was so upset that, I mean, he was really just, I mean, it just crushed my grandfather and my grandmother when he died. And they never were the same. He, my grandfather at the time was Chief Justice of the Supreme Court in Georgia. And he just gave it up. And he spent a good part of his life after that trying to find out what happened down to the last granular detail up until the moment of his son's death. And one of the things that he found out from two different sources was that when the ship sank and they all had to go on to life rafts, and when they abandoned the ship, they all went on to life rafts or you know, ad hoc life rafts, whatever was floating around. And he was floating with one of the men on the, with some of his men on the life raft, and eventually just sort of slipped away and disappeared. But when things always stuck in my mind is this cryptic sort of mantra, a koan almost. Two different people reported to my grandfather that he had said, tell the folks everything's going to be all right. And and it seems really weird, you know, that since it obviously wasn't all right, it wasn't all right for them. But I think over the long arc of our family history, bring us all the way down right now to Curtis, everything has been all right. You know, we've had great lives, and it was sort of the way he imagined it would be, because that's what it is that he thought about his own life. That somehow or other, everything, whatever happened at particular points, whatever crises came along at particular junctures, everything in the long arc, to quote your person, would be good, and it was. And I am proud to have been his son, and of course, all of his time. I'm glad to have him saluted by this group and by John. And thank you very much. And my mother thanks you. She wishes she could be here too, but if she were here, she would still be jabbering away. And I'm like, thank you. So thank you.
Now my pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Robert Pratt, Professor of History at the University of Georgia, to induct Taylor Branch.
Good morning. Born in Atlanta, Georgia. I won't give the year. Taylor Branch is a Pulitzer Prize winning nonfiction author, perhaps best known for his trilogy of books centered on the life and work of Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. Branch is a graduate of the Westminster School in Atlanta, and received his undergraduate degree at the University of North Carolina. He also earned an advanced degree from the Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs at Princeton University. In the 1970s, he was an editor for the Washington Monthly and Harper's Magazine, and also served as the Washington Affairs columnist for Esquire magazine. He was active in the 1972 Democratic presidential campaign of Senator George McGovern of South Dakota, working alongside his roommate, Bill Clinton. You will forgive me for saying so. Glad about that election turned out, you and Bill might have committed yourselves to other pursuits. His many books include Horn and the Whistle, Dissent in the Public Interest, published in 1972, Second Queen, a biography of pro basketball star Bill Russell, Boston Celtics, published in 1974. The first of the King trilogy, Parting the Waters, America in the King Years, 1954 to 1963, which won the Pulitzer Prize for History and the National Book Award in 1988. About that particular book, one reviewer wrote, "Right out of the pages of our lives, compelling portraits placed in the excitement of a period when oppressed and powerless people moving together changed themselves and their country profoundly and permanently." In 1998, Branch published Pillar of Fire, America in the King Years, 1963 to 1965, the second in the trilogy. Of that book, one reviewer wrote, "By the time you have finished Pillar of Fire, you feel almost as if you have relived the era, not just read about it." Published in 2006, At Cannon's Edge, America in the King Years, 1965 to 1968, concludes the trilogy. Of that book, one reviewer wrote, "The crowning achievement of Branch's trilogy, now complete, is to show anew the moral power of King's nonviolent philosophy." His 2009 memoir, The Clinton Tapes, Wrestling History with the President, chronicles an unprecedented 8-year project to gather a sitting president's comprehensive oral history on tape. His cover story for the October 2011 issue of The Atlantic, titled "The Shame of College Sports," touched off an ongoing national debate. One commentator wrote that this might be the most important article ever written about college sports. Mr. Branch returns to civil rights in his latest book, The King Years, Historic Moments in the Civil Rights Movement, published in 2013. In addition to his writing, which has been prolific, over his life, he speaks before a wide variety of audiences all over the country and the world. Branch currently resides in Baltimore, received the MacArthur Foundation Genius Grant in 1991, and has also received the National Humanities Medal from President Clinton in 1999. Having taught Taylor Branch's books in my classes for more than 25 years now, I'm not Uncle Pedro. I can attest to the profound influence that his work has had on the way we understand the civil rights movement. His work has not only influenced, but has also helped to shape and define the contours of our collective narrative of the civil rights movement. His is among those works for those of us who study and teach civil rights history consider to be must reading in order to gain a full appreciation of this nation during the King years. Now, while King is clearly at the center of the narrative, the beauty of Branch's masterful storytelling is the fact that he sheds light on the many lesser knowns, the unsung heroes of the movement. The best example of this is his very first chapter in Parting the Waters, the first in his trilogy, which he devotes entirely to the life of the Reverend Vernon Johns, who preceded King, as some of you perhaps did not know, as the pastor of Dexter Avenue Baptist Church in Montgomery, Alabama. Considered by many to be the father of the civil rights movement, Vernon Johns had, for the most part, existed only in the shadows until Branch rescued him from obscurity. That first chapter, which is devoted entirely to Johns, is appropriately entitled Forerunner. I can think of no other book published prior to Branches that had so much as even a passing reference to this powerful black preacher who single-handedly prepared the congregation of Dexter Avenue Baptist Church for Martin Luther King Jr. when he arrived, and for the role that both would ultimately play in the Montgomery bus boycott of 1955. This is the kind of scholarship that has helped to influence a generation of new scholars wishing to study and read and teach civil rights history. Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me distinct pleasure to introduce to you, and please join me in welcoming Mr. Taylor Branch.
Professor Pratt, for those kind remarks, and thanks to the University of Georgia. I am thrilled to be here with a lot of branches. they're all over the place. I thought, in a way, when I first heard about this, that I've been gone from Georgia too long. And my dad, I wish my dad could be here. He said basically that Atlanta has been a boom town ever since I left in 1964. I've been gone, and I thought maybe, gosh, that I wasn't Georgia enough anymore. And then I meet Vereen Bell, and his mother lives on North Court Street in Quitman, Georgia, where my dad's mother lived. And we used to go down there all the time and fish and hunt with Cousin Branch, who had bees out in the backyard there in Quitman. So that's about as southern as you can get. My dad said people in Quitman, that a Methodist was a Baptist who had learned to read. A Presbyterian was a Methodist who had moved to the city, not Quitman, a bigger city. And that an Episcopalian was a Presbyterian who loved to drink. About all we needed to know for education. My family is full of popisms in language. We also, of course, I met Janisse Ray. I've been thrilled to read her books, and in the books I knew some of this, that her family is full of branches too, and that she has a Lee Ada branch, maybe here for all I know. Well, my dad had an aunt named Ada and an uncle named Lee, both branches. So we're probably all related. And there's a lot more branch than I thought. My dad had a gift for language that we preserved in all these popisms that he related to people. But I carried a lot of those around with me from him, and he's really also my parents. My mom's from Birmingham, and although neither one of them really encouraged me to go into the civil rights movement, I said yesterday that most people who speak of being involved are lying, because it was quite scary for white people at the time, and it was scary for black people at the time. It was only a tiny minority of people who got involved, and any kind of mixed room like this would have sweaty palms instantly, because nobody knew exactly how it would relate, and we got out of that. But my mom had a blissful commitment to injustice, and would meet with all these ladies who were concerned about it in the Georgia Humanities Council. My dad said that was terrible. Don't get involved in politics. In fact, his phrase was, people interested in politics can't find honest work. Therefore, you shouldn't be involved in politics at all. And yet, every now and then, he had little things that he would do. We would go to the Atlanta Crackers baseball games, the Ponceliano Ballpark in Atlanta. Yes, our team was the Crackers. People outside of Georgia don't understand that. And they certainly don't understand how the Negro Leagues team was the Atlanta Black Crackers. But it's true. And we would drive down to the Crackers game in the laundry truck. And often we would go with Peter Mitchell, the cleaner. And he and Dad had this banter relationship where they'd be telling jokes the whole way. And then the jokes would die out as we got near the ballpark because Peter had to separate and go sit in the colored section. And we'd have to meet afterwards. And on one or two, this is in the 1950s, and on one or two occasions, we'd be walking along after Peter had separated, and Dad would be in kind of a gloomy funk, but he wouldn't say anything. And he said, I don't like this. And I knew that he wasn't saying get involved in doing something about segregation. He didn't even mention segregation. I knew he didn't mean that because he was against politics. But I knew he just didn't like the fact that we had to separate and that there was a natural bond that he had with Peter and it was broken because of this. But what I also knew was that this was my dad, and when he said, I don't like this, I knew even as an 8-year-old or a 10-year-old that I wasn't supposed to say one more word about this. This was a radioactive subject beneath the surface, the relationship between blacks and whites in Georgia. And that it upset him, but that somehow in that age you could communicate the reality that this was not something to go into to your son simply by one sentence. I don't like this. And so when the civil rights era was so relentless through all of my childhood that it persisted, it just kept going. I said yesterday I was a first grader the year of the Brown decision. I started high school the year of the Freedom Rides. I finished high school the year of Mississippi Summer and the Civil Rights Bill. And I graduated from college in the spring that Dr. King was killed. So from first grade until the end of college, these landmarks were there and these terrifying things were there, bringing up this subterranean subject around which we organized most of our history and a good deal of our politics somewhat beneath the surface and in denial. And so I wanted to know where it came from and where this movement came from and how little girls could march into dogs and fire hoses singing songs that I sang in Sunday school. I ultimately decided that the people who led that movement were leaders for all of the country in understanding the true depths of what the democratic promise that makes this country so new and still such a hope in the world, where it came from. And that for that brief moment in time, the leaders of democracy, the modern founding fathers, were largely African Americans. And I believe to this day that until all the rest of us accept that and stop trying to pigeonhole it as something that was about selfish things that were quaint on who sat where in the bus long ago and that don't apply to our future, that we do that as our peril. This was an incredible moment. And all the people that I met reinforced that. I had a hard time doing a lot of this work, but I want to end with one story relating to what Professor Pratt said about Vernon Johns. I had interviewed people all over the country, black ministers, and had a terrible time getting them to take me seriously. They got what I called the Martin increased in wisdom and stature and favor with God and man, and I was his best friend interview. That's all I could get. And I particularly got that from Ralph Abernathy, who wouldn't give me the time of day. I interviewed him 4 or 5 times. Then, when I was in Memphis, a bunch of people in Memphis after Dr. King was killed got together, like the people in this room, and said, something profound has happened here. Let's form a group to go out and collect everything we can find about what happened in the sanitation strike and preserve it for the future so people can understand it. And they did oral histories. There's the Mississippi Valley project. And they put it there in Memphis. And I went through all the papers, but they did something else. They collected all the outtakes of the TV from the TV news stations before they were destroyed. This is in a time when, and you know, Georgia is good at that too, all the Peabody stuff that you have here. Well, I started looking at these outtakes. And on the day of the King assassination, there were outtakes of this young white reporter about the age that I was then, this is a long time ago, trying to interview Abernathy at the morgue. Dr. Abernathy, what happened? Did you see Dr. King? Did he say anything? And Abernathy was kind of in a trance and completely ignoring this person, which made me, of course, identify with the reporter, because that's more or less the way Abernathy treated me. And he kept asking these questions, and Abernathy ignored him. And then finally he said, well, if you can't tell me what happened, can you tell me when you first met Dr. King? And Abernathy came out of his trance and said, young man, I first met Dr. King, my life's partner, on the cold January morning when he arrived at my parsonage in Montgomery, Alabama, in the company of the greatest prophet we ever knew, Vernon Johns. And he said, I sold ladies' lingerie on the streets of Montgomery, which was the most humiliating thing I've ever done, because Vernon Johns convinced me that that was a service that would connect me to people. And then he started telling Vernon Johns stories. And one after another. And he just went into this reverie, and the reporter got very, very frustrated. He had a hard time getting him going, then he couldn't stop him. He said, but you know, Chicago's burning, the riots are happening. And Abernathy ignored him. So I figured, I saw all this, I said, this guy Vernon Johns must be pretty significant. So I went around and started asking people about Vernon Johns, and every time I asked a black preacher about Vernon Johns, out would come this treasure trove of stories from that were not recorded anywhere. They were just part of folk literature. But the next time I went to Abernathy, I asked him some Vernon Johns story, and it was like putting a key in the engine, and it changed my whole relationship with him and most of the other people. So stories are the key to race relations. And surprise always underlies a good story. And I think that people in Georgia have an aptitude for that, because we live in stories and they make us human. The race relations stories are still a radioactive subject, but for me, they've been enthralling and a very, very worthwhile profession to have. I still think we need to stick with them. And I'm happy that my family is still here so that I can come home and be reminded where I got started, right in my family and from my dad and everything, studying this. So thank you very much.
Great. Appreciate that. And inducting Paul Hemphill, please welcome to the podium Georgia Writers Hall of Fame inductee, Terry Kay.
Thank you. What I am going to say about Paul is extremely personal, but I've reached that good age where it's permissible, perhaps even advisable, to set aside restraints of political correctness and to say what is true in my mind, even if others might regard it in a disagreeable manner. Today I want to say that this induction of Paul Hemphill into the Georgia Writers Hall of Fame is overdue. He should have been here years ago, for he met and exceeded standards of membership and every prerequisite we could apply to candidates, especially in the most important requirement. He could write. My God, he could write. Paul died in July of 2009 in his 73rd year. I was asked by his wife, Susan, to speak at his service, a request I considered a significant honor, for I would be eulogizing a friend that I greatly admired. I've asked Susan's permission to borrow from those words today because they reflect as well as I can possibly express it my personal and professional regard for a man who rose above his own early expectations to become a significant force in that small community of writers from the 70s and 80s that inspired the renaissance of writing, especially fiction writing, in the state of Georgia. These are some of the words I said of Paul on that day. Of course, we will tell his stories. Stories from manuals and the mills and from all the other places where he took a chair and settled in for a libation and a smoke and a talk growing out of that moment. We will tell the stories he told, or we will tell of his telling of them. Stories of street people and the well-to-do, stories of the down and out, stories of the celebrated, stories of people wailing in despair, and of people howling in laughter. Stories of politicians spinning spiels and wives cracking rednecks in barbecue joints, spinning cliches. Stories of race baiters hanging on to a sordid history, and stories of reformers bearing dreams. Stories of second basemen longing for the bigs, of boy men strutting to band music, preening in the glory of football, of the sons of thunder, descendants of the whiskey runners who took to stock car racing in a blood kinship of speed and noise. Stories of those who made it, and stories of those who fell short, the big shots and the hangers-on. These were the people that Paul wrote about, the people he wrote for. Few honorees inducted into this esteemed fellowship of writers ever mingled with so many unique people bearing such unique stories. Celestine Sibley and Ralph McGill, perhaps, but few others. He sat behind me at the Atlanta Journal, close enough that I could hear the clacking Morse code of his typewriter as he wrote of the places and of the people that fashioned his stories. For Paul, it was a giddy way to make a living. It might as well have been held in a circus tent with calliope music blaring away and copy boys hawking cotton candy between editions. He reveled in it, and believe me, for a special period of time. Paul Hemphill was the face of the Atlanta Journal for readers who wanted to swing a ride on the merry-go-round of change that defined Atlanta and the South in those days. For me, I thought Paul had something of the personality of Don Quixote, ready to saddle a skinny horse and charge windmills. I have no idea why that image comes to mind, but it does. Put him in a period costume and place a shaving bowl hat on his head, and give him a lance and you'll get the picture. Maybe it was his angular theatrical look, or maybe it was his forlorn nature when he got to pontificating in his deep chest, slow measured voice, or maybe it was because much of his writing was about impossible dreams, his own and those of others. For years, he and I carried on a gentle exchange about what he should be writing. I urged him to stick with fiction, for I thought he had the ear and the eye for it, a natural talent that few writers are blessed with. It was a skittish subject with him. He felt more comfortable with nonfiction, and I learned that my arguments were useless. Today I questioned why I even debated the point with him. You cannot read Leaving Birmingham, Notes of a Native Son, which in my opinion should have won the Pulitzer Prize, and wonder if he missed his calling. Still, he wrote fiction, including Long Gone, a novel about minor league baseball that was produced as a popular HBO movie. His other works of fiction were The Six Killer Chronicles, King of the Road, and the remarkable Nobody's Hero. His first book, though, was nonfiction, The Nashville Sound, Bright Lights and Country Music, and it would become his signature work. Published in 1970, it is still regarded as an expressive and definitive insight into the culture of country music industry. It also set the standard of his nonfiction that followed, including The Heart of the Game, A Story of a Minor League Baseball Player, and Wheels, a season on NASCAR's Winston Cup Circuit. Also in that genre was Lovesick Blues, a biography of Hank Williams, and his final book published in 2008, A Tiger Walk Through History, The Story of Auburn University Football. Too Old to Cry is there, as is The Battle of Little River, a tale of race and unrest in the rural South. And Me and the Boy, Journey of Discovery, Father and Son on the Appalachian Trail. You will also find two other collections, The Good Old Boys and Lost in the Lights, Sports, Dreams, and Life. Regardless of drama or genre, you will find in his offerings fragments of the mystery and adventure of who we are, or might have been, or could be. All of us, young and old, man and woman, blessed and bedeviled. And in them you will find Paul Hemphill, writer. He was born in Birmingham, Alabama in 1936, the son of a truck driver who would inspire much of his writing. He had a walk-to-bitty dream of being a Major League Baseball player, though he did not play high school baseball. Yet that did not deter him. And he made his way to the Class D Alabama-Florida League in a tryout with the Graceful Oilers, where he learned that a curveball was a mystifying reality, not an optical illusion. Good sense sent him to college at Auburn University, where he became a writer for the school newspaper and an intern at the Birmingham News. That was the beginning of it, the beginning of being a newspaper man, which in those days was different from being a journalist. Anyone could be a journalist. You had to bring your A game to be a newspaper man. Over the years, he took that game from Birmingham to Augusta and Tampa and finally to Atlanta, first with the upstart but doomed Atlanta Times and then with the Atlanta Journal. At the Journal, he was a war correspondent in Vietnam and a daily columnist with great following. He was awarded the prestigious Demon Fellowship at the Harvard University, where he began the writing of the Nashville Sound. Back in Georgia, he wrote and taught at Emory, in Bernal, and here at the University of Georgia, and he became an icon for a congregation of devoted friends and followers that gathered in Manuel's Tavern with such regularity, it was considered by many, then and now, as an order of happy celebrants toasting the splendor of words. Paul loved those gatherings. He loved the pure joy of being in the company of writers and readers. He loved the noise of laughter, the harmless banter that echoed like maniacal fans at some hyped up sporting event. And that always impressed me, for watching him, there was something about Paul that followed him like a shadow, at least in my view. He had a great yearning to know he belonged. The same as a child not born to privilege yearns for something he sees from a distance. I am not sure if others saw that in him, but I did. And I am not sure he ever wholly conquered that uncertainty, that restlessness. But I am certain it was the core of his sensitivity, made from a curious mix of doubt and determination, and I believe it inspired the best of his writing. He knew that belonging was not a gift. It was an achievement, boldly earned. And that is why we are here today. We're here to say, yes, Paul, you belong. You always have. You earned it long, long before this day. And for those assembled here to celebrate that affirmation, his wife, Susan, his children, his grandchildren, his friends, this is merely the public boast of what each of you have always understood from your history with him. He would be smiling over it, wouldn't he? If gladness had an aura, he would be wearing it like an expensive garment, and the room would radiate in its glow. It's why I regret we have waited so long to honor him. His gladness would have dazzled all of us, leaving all of us to better understand what it means to be a maker of words. He was special, this man who could not hit a curveball, but he could write. My God, he could write. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Paul James Hemphill, Hall of Famer.
I'm actually not sure why I thought I could listen to Terry Kay talk about my husband without crying, but did have to go site to purchase some waterproof mascara, and I hope that's helping. Terry, thank you so much for those wonderful words. I can just say with absolute certainty there's no one that Paul would rather have had introduce him. He admired you greatly as a writer, as I think you know, and he loved you like a brother, which I hope you also know. To everyone at the University of Georgia Libraries and the Georgia Writers Hall of Fame, and special shout out to my colleague and friend Neely Young, thank you. I want to thank you on behalf of our family. We have a very respectable representation here. Paul's three daughters, three sons-in-law, four grandchildren, Kai, Isabella, Henry, Alice, Paul's sister and brother-in-law, Joyce and Jim, and a whole bunch of friends and well-wishers, and I believe they joined me in thanking you for this, and probably have the same thought I did, that Paul would have loved this gathering. I mean, you know, family, friends, books, readers, writers. I mean, it's his kind of, absolutely his kind of place. And this honor in particular would mean a great deal to him, knowing that it will probably help his work reach even more readers, and more people will be able to share in all of his wonderful writings. He used to say when he was complaining that he didn't make a lot of money from his work, which actually happened probably more frequently than you might think, but he would say that he guessed he was writing for the libraries, not for fame and fortune. So this library honor would be, you know, very, very gratifying to him. And it's especially meaningful for me to be able to accept this award from the university I love for the best writer I ever knew. And, you know, he was an Auburn guy. I realize that probably took some finagling with the committee. Had a very soft spot in his heart for Georgia, and in fact, it really only hardened, you know, one fall November Saturday afternoon every year. But you know, he was a wonderful guy. No, you know, nobody's perfect, but he had a special place in his heart for Georgia, as I of course do. And I just want to thank you so very much.
Now inducting Janisse Ray is Dorinda Dahlmeyer, Director of the Environmental Ethics Certificate Program at the University of Georgia. Dorinda?
Good morning. nothing ever happens in Georgia. As I was growing up in Macon, my elementary school science book spoke of blizzards. We didn't have blizzards in Macon. They described the northern lights. You couldn't see them there. I was convinced you couldn't even see the Milky Way in Macon until my parents realized exactly how nearsighted I was. We children had no choice but to make our own observations and theories. My sister Beth and I would lie atop Scutman Arbor on sunny winter days and watch the sky. I decided the clouds were fixed in place, and thus that I could detect the earth turning on its axis beneath them. The neighborhood children, who made up a barefoot royal society, decided by consensus that the velvety Catawba worms appearing in June were spontaneously generated from the flowers that had bloomed on the trees a few weeks before. No sphinx moths were needed. Our school books generally ignored what lay around us, the rolling Piedmont, the pinelands, the coastal plain. What we got was dose after dose of high mountains, vast prairies, the desert, and New England. Nothing that looked like home. Even poet and fellow Maconite Sidney Lanier focused elsewhere on Georgia's coastal marshes and the Chattahoochee, once publishing a tourist guide to Florida. If our landscapes happened to appear in print, it was as some backdrop, a stage set against which the book's characters played out their lives. All that changed for me in 1999 with the appearance of Janisse Ray's Ecology of a Cracker Childhood. Yes, her book was full of people, but it wove their lives inextricably with lives lived in parallel within the longleaf forest. Here was someone who made her own childhood forays into that wild world, made her own observations and discoveries, opened up herself to signs and wonders, and found wholeness in a place others thought not worth a second look. She was native to my place, and when I first heard her read from the book here on campus, to my ears, she spoke without an accent. Not only did Janisse enter my world, she burst onto the literary scene as an overnight sensation. The New York Times critic said, "The forests of the South find their Rachel Carson." Her book won a host of awards, including the prestigious American Book Award. It was named a New York Times notable book and selected as the book all Georgians should read. And indeed, Janisse continues to be a moving force, reconnecting Georgians to our natural heritage so long ignored. But this overnight sensation was many years in the making and in the unfolding. Janisse's sense of place, her rootedness within the web of the living world, runs through all her books. Wild Card Quilt chronicles her return with her son Silas to her hometown of Baxley, Georgia, to renew her connections with the places and the people who helped to shape who she is. In Pinhook, she took readers into the unheralded heart of the largest expanse of protected wildland east of the Mississippi River, 750,000 acres spanning the Georgia-Florida border. 2 years later, Janisse used her words to spearhead the preservation of Moody Forest along her beloved Altamaha. She's also the author of poetry collections, co-editor of numerous anthologies, and continues to contribute essays to books, to literary journals like our Georgia Review, and a wide variety of popular magazines. If all this writing is not enough to keep her busy, she leads workshops around the country, shaping the next wave of nature writers who will protect the places they love. In 2011, she turned her gaze from the land of longleaf pines to the river that waters them and nourishes its people. In drifting into Darien, Janisse went to the river seeking solace from sickness and pain in her family. And like so many before, she found redemption in its waters, her words restoring our souls. Janisse once told me that all she really ever wanted to do was be a farmer. Now she leads that life at Red Earth Farm near Reidsville, faithfully tended by Janisse and her husband, Raven Waters. The first time I arrived there, an eternally optimistic piney woods rooter snuffled around its pen. Languid goats munched peanut hay. Greeting me was what I first thought to be the friendliest flock of chickens and guineas on earth. Only later did I realize it wasn't me they were happy to see, but my car, plastered with insects, mashed in transit. Drawing on her lifelong passion for plants and heirloom seeds and from the rich soil of Red Earth Farm, Janisse's most recent book emerged, The Seed Underground, A Growing Revolution to Save Food. Janisse is part of that revolution and more. Long ago, she drew a lesson in courage from the still beating heart of a roadkill snapping turtle. Janisse has put her heart and words and sometimes her body on the line, protesting the devastation wrought by mountaintop removal coal mining in Appalachia, taking a stand against state and federal agencies that would sell our birthright for a mess of pottage, and challenging an economic system's willful disregard for its impact on the only world we will ever have. Some have called her radical. They miss the irony that radical comes from the Latin word for root. Janisse is so deeply rooted in her beloved landscapes. What else could she do? Let me conclude with these thoughts. For me, the best writing is not when the author speaks to you, but stands next to you. Janisse, pointing out a pitcher plant flower you might overlook. You, crouching with her on the floor of a John boat as men rustle an alligator at the gunwale. The two of you diving into the Altamaha, swimming stroke for stroke as you go to the aid of a friend swept downstream. About 10 years ago, I tucked an anthology of Southern nature writing, The Woods Stretched for Miles, into my carry-on bag. And on my way to Europe, I read Janisse's account of seeing kestrels, sparrowhawks, hovering over southeastern skies in Montana. Each year as winter approached, kestrels would arrive in Baxley to spend the winter there, much to her grandmother's delight. They were her birds. For Janisse, then in academic exile in Montana, the kestrels stitched her to her family so far away. Later, on my trip, I would stand beside a Georgia soldier's grave in Normandy, a man buried facing west, toward America, toward home, and I looked up to find kestrels overhead. Signs and wonders indeed for my friend back in Georgia. Over the years that I've been collaborating with Janisse Ray, I have lost count of the number of times I've been asked to introduce her. But one thing I do know is that I never have to repeat myself because she's always doing something new. She cured me of thinking that nothing ever happens in Georgia. Like lightning in the longleaf, Janisse is a bright flame who has lit a fire under so many of us and promises to do so again and again. Please join me in welcoming Janisse Ray.
Much for this honor. Allow me to thank my friend Dorinda for her encompassing, eloquent introduction. Dorinda and I met 15 years ago, and I quickly learned of her love of nature, especially Southern nature, and her love of our place. Life never gets boring around Dorinda, and she's not afraid to tackle the most monumental of ideas. Not only is she visionary, she's an incredibly hard worker, and I'm grateful for the day I was fortunate enough to meet her. Thank you for a lifetime of friendship, Dorinda, for laboring daily on behalf of wildness, and for all the love brimming and spilling over in your heart. Thanks for my parents, Franklin and Leeta Ray, who by great effort are here today. They purchased a television set when they married in 1957. Then promptly threw it out of the house a year later when my sister Kay was born. In the silence that ensued, I was able to hear the wind, the rain, the thunder, the hiss of chicken frying. I was able to turn to reading. I thank my parents for giving us children free run of the public library. Thanks to them for putting me in places where as a child I could learn the tremendous power of stories. Places like my grandmother's porch on a Sunday afternoon with leather wings zooming around and barred owls yodeling from the branch, the smell of wild roses in the air. Or my mother's kitchen where a hobo had been invited in for a meal. Or the marble steps of the old post office in downtown Baxley where our box number 62 had belonged to my great-grandfather. My childhood was one of connections in that everybody was connected to everybody else, usually in multiple ways. The characters in the stories we heard, and we heard stories endlessly, were people we knew, people connected to people we knew. The settings of the stories were also places we knew. We understood ourselves then to be part of a vast literature. Stories have at least two models. They have multiple points of contact, like spider webs, and they have layers like the earth itself. I learned that as a child from my crazy story-haunted people. That I was immersed in my culture, culture a set of stories we tell ourselves to understand life in a place. I thank my parents for that. Mostly I thank them for giving me life and for their unmitigated support of my work. Before my first book was published, when there was only the promise of it in a catalog, my father went around town selling copies. Of the 10,000 hardbacks printed in the first edition, he sold 1,000 of them. He has been my best bookseller so far, his mission statement being that any book sold could turn into a silver bullet, striking the heart of Oprah, of the editor of the New York Times Review of Books, of the Georgia Writers Hall of Fame judges. Thank you. My loving and loyal brother, Franklin Delano Ray Jr., whom we call Dell, is here along with his beautiful wife. They really should make pills that keep you from crying up here. My sister-in-law, Rita. Dell and Rita live in our hometown, as do my parents. My brother and I are very close. My sister Kay, who knows my story better than anyone and who is an art quilter of immense talent, is here with her husband, Tom Amsler, an anesthesiologist in New Bern, North Carolina, as well as their son, my nephew Ian, who is a thinker who is finding his way in the world and setting his own path. My nephew CJ, son of my brother Stephen, drove my parents to Athens this morning. He is a kind, ethical, altogether honorable young man who also lives in Baxley. Many thanks to my husband, Raven Waters, a potter, an artist. At 62, Raven has gone back to school at Georgia Southern, where he's working on a degree in ceramics. He's a husbandman, a farmer, a furniture maker, a bowl turner, a community activist, a true Renaissance man. I have seen Raven do things that no other person could or would be able to do. And in that regard, he is also Superman. Thank you, Raven. Two important people are not here today, and they are my children. Silas is 27. He's finished a degree in environmental design from the University of Massachusetts, Amherst, although his true passion in life has not yet been revealed. A month ago, he moved with a group of young friends to Boulder, where he hikes in the Flatirons, tinkers on his banjo, and takes wonderful photographs. He wanted to be here. 3.5 years ago, my husband and I became mama and papa to our little half-niece, now 11. Our journey with Sky has been one of intense healing. So that Raven and I can better enjoy these events this weekend, our daughter is with a safe and competent respite provider in North Carolina. She too wanted to be here. We have dear friends who returned to a family farm in the coastal plain from careers in Atlanta, Dan and Ellen Corey. Dan is a poet, Ellen a gardener. Both are naturalists restoring longleaf pine and pollinators at Longleaf Dharma Farm near Tifton. Their love and friendship are invaluable to me, and I thank them for it. While in Athens, we lodged with two friends that we are profoundly grateful to have, the landscape painter destined for immortality, Philip Juris, and his artist wife, Beth Gavrilis. Time spent with the two of them bring us vast quantities of joy. Thank you. Over the one score and inflorescent years of my writing life, many people have upheld, supported, cheered, polished, and loved me. Some of them have already entered a starry fold of the universe, and some were not able to be here but wanted to. And many that I have not named are here in this room, helping me bear the crosses I bear, helping me carry them, supporting me despite my flaws, and celebrating this honor that I look upon as an honor not only for my work, but for all who understand that we're part of something bigger than ourselves, that we are all tasked with the stewardship of creation, that we are responsible for each other and all living things, and that we are the world and the future of the world. Many people are better writers than I. Many people are better defenders than I. Many people despair less, question less, grieve less. But my life has been a decades-long apprenticeship to writing, motivated by a belief in the power of story to transcend, send, and to transform. The human seeks to be transcendent, to be effervescent, to be magical. The human seeks a life that has meaning. We want things to make sense, to be explained. Coming from darkness, all of us, from nothingness, we continually seek light and somethingness. There are many avenues to transformation, many approaches to the light. Stories are just one way, but they're the way I was taught, the way I know. My belief in them has been total. A story is a boat, an ark, floating on the troubled waters of the floods, and there is room enough and light enough in the boat for all of us. The South, especially, is a storied place, and I am proud to be a Southern writer, a Georgia writer. Kick over any pine log in the forest and find a rakish story to test a writer's belief and skill. The question not, what is the story, but always, can I do it justice? The South is a place that births its own writers, as canted as the characters it produces, and to tell its stories, and it always has. O'Connor and Caldwell and Miller would draw their nets across the pine flatwoods and hill country and bayous and shake out books. Southern writers belong by grace of geography and fiber to those people desirous and sometimes able to rake a rich and bizarre humus onto paper. We inherited the treasure of stories layering the forest floor. I have always said that fame, by any definition, means almost nothing to me. And money is useful only as a means of survival and of making faith visible. Success to me is restored and greening landscapes, the interactions of humans with nature, news of the proliferation and health of the world's biota. Success is hearing of our love for our places, of our people, of nature, and decisions that honor this love. I thank you all for this great honor to allow me to join the Georgia writers whose work has informed me, shaped me, cradled me. We live in a society that goes to great lengths to honor its celebrities, its stars, its fame seekers, and the writers often get marginalized, ostracized, derided, ignored. Therefore, I thank the Board of Judges of the Georgia Writers Hall of Fame, especially Toby Graham, University Librarian, and I thank all the people who made this weekend possible. I thank those who submitted my name to the panel and to the board for electing me to be part of this fine pantheon. One of my dreams has come true. My hope is to continue to do justice to the stories that I have been given, to be faithful to the craft and the art of our literature, to love my place and my people, boundlessly, to speak for the earth itself, all its miraculous interconnected forms of life, and to be an honor to you all. Thank you.
Wouldn't we all love Monday mornings if we spit a ball like this? This special day, I do want to say, is part of a series of programming going on all over this this fine university. It's called Spotlight on the Arts. It's a festival that that does shine a light on all of the visual arts, the literary arts, the performing arts here at the University of Georgia, more than 60 events happening across campus. And so we encourage you to attend many of those. I want to draw your attention to an exhibit in the Harvard Library's gallery just down the hall. And Skip Hewlett, where is Skip? He may be preparing for the, right over here. Skip has prepared an exhibit that is dedicated to this year's inductees, and so we encourage you to enjoy that. Also, in 2012, the Georgia Review issued a special provided a special issue that is dedicated to the Georgia Writers Hall of Fame, and it's a really nice way to be introduced to many of the writers who had been inducted up to that point. And so that's available just outside as well, and I'm sure that Dr. Corey would be happy to help you with that. So with that, I would just thank everyone for coming. We appreciate your support for the Georgia Writers Hall of Fame programming, and let's give one more round of applause for Janisse Ray, for Taylor Branch, and to the memory of Paula Hemphill and Vereen Bell.